A big thank you to CuriosityStream for sponsoring today's video.
So now that the postponing of the 2024 Artemis moon landing date is all but a certainty, can China maybe use this situation to their advantage and return humans to the moon before NASA? And how would SpaceX with their Starship fit into all of this?
Then of course let's also take a look at the Crew-1 mission, but of course we'll also take a look at the recent progress of SpaceX's Starship at Boca Chica. What's going on there now after the almost disastrous SN8 static fire test? Will this delay the 15-kilometer hop for a long time? A lot to talk about as always, so stay tuned.
It's becoming pretty clear now that NASA won't be able to hold the 2024 moon landing timeline. But what exactly does that mean for the international competition? On this channel, we have been talking very often about a kind of emerging Cold War situation between the US and China, especially regarding spaceflight. The creation of the US Space Force was an immediate reaction to China's growing power in space, and more. The Chinese space program makes absolutely no secret out of the fact that they also want to land humans on the moon, coincidentally by the end of the 2020s. We argued in our last video that the new Artemis moon landing date is now most likely 2028, a date that had been mentioned several times, and actually was the moon landing date before the Trump administration set a new aggressive goal of landing on the moon in 2024. Only back in September 18th, on a space conference in China, the new Chinese moon rocket was presented, which looks very similar to a Falcon Heavy. This as yet unnamed rocket will be 285 feet, or 87 meters long, with a three-stage central core, and it's being designed at the China Academy of Launch Vehicle Technology in Beijing. They also showed more details on how they exactly would want to perform the moon landings. We talked about it in this video here. But interestingly, the date for this moon landing is the late 2020s.
So it could get really interesting date-wise between NASA and the Chinese space agency CNSA. In addition to this, the Russian space agency Roscosmos, under its really entertaining chief Dmitry Rogozin, has been distancing itself more and more from the US in the last years. Rogozin, for example, called the Artemis program too US-centric and said that China seemed a more interesting partner for future manned moon missions. The Russian space agency Roscosmos has an annual budget of about $2 billion, and the Chinese space agency has an annual budget of $11 billion. So together, the two space agencies have $13 billion annually at their disposal. While this doesn't sound really impressive when comparing it to NASA's $23.5 billion fiscal year 2021 budget, basically being only a bit more than half, we should keep in mind that they could direct almost their entire resources towards the moon program, should they decide to shift in high gear. Currently, however, CNSA is still planning to build a space station in low Earth orbit, which is projected to cost quite a few billion dollars. So therefore, China wouldn't have enough to pursue an aggressive moon landing date. Should China be smart, however, and see the postponement of the Artemis moon landing date to 2028 as their big chance, then they could forego the space station and completely focus on the moon, together with their new Russian allies. They could pour almost the entirety of their combined $13 billion annually into the new moon program and collaborate on a joint manned moon mission for 2028. China already has the deep space capsule. They successfully tested it this year. We like to call the capsule Red Dragon because it looks so similar to SpaceX's Crew Dragon. And red, well, you know, you can guess why. So some of the infrastructure necessary for the moon landings is already there. Russia could, for example, only concentrate on the moon lander, while CNSA could fully concentrate on the heavy lift rocket, the deep space capsule, and the service module for the moon missions.
This way, China and Russia really could have a chance to land astronauts on the moon in 2028, maybe even shortly before NASA's Artemis 3 mission would land. This would be interesting for several reasons. First, the US would probably feel challenged, and this might finally lead to more funding for NASA, because we can be very sure that China and Russia would build a moon base. They are also very open about that. And a moon base has been in both nations' plans since a very long time ago. The US certainly wouldn't like China and Russia to have a joint moon base. So therefore, the Senate would probably unanimously approve more funding for NASA to build the Artemis moon base, which might develop to an international moon base led by the US. So this could actually prove to be an excellent development for the US manned space exploration effort, because we would end up having a NASA and international moon base by 2030, together with a Chinese and Russian moon base. And if you want to support our YouTube channel and help us to continue making videos about exciting space news, as well as exposing lobbyism and corruption in the spaceflight industry, then please have a look at our favorite stream service for documentaries, Curiosity Stream. We have been using it for quite a while now, and lately we watched Mars, Mysterious Red Planet, a spectacularly well-done documentary on our second most favorite planet. But there are so many more interesting documentaries. For example, if you are like us, very interested in the possibility of life on faraway exoplanets, Living Universe might be perfect for you.
As you can see, there are just thousands of high-quality documentaries on CuriosityStream, including many award-winning exclusives and originals. And the best thing is, you can watch all the shows anytime, anywhere, and from any device you like. Smart TV, PC, smartphone, tablet, you name it. In our opinion, the best value for the money would be the HD annual subscription, and you can even get 25% off by using our discount code to the future, meaning that it will cost only $14.99 for a whole year.
There are no hidden automatic renewals or stuff like that, so you can really just try it out without any worries. Stay curious, sign up today, and start to watch the best documentaries for only $14.99 for a whole year.
But then, of course, the important question arises: how does SpaceX fit into all of this? Well, we know that Elon's main focus is Mars, and not the moon. But we have to remain realistic that because the moon is so much nearer than Mars, it would be the ideal testing ground for Starship. We are quite sure that with the new delayed NASA moon return timeline, the SpaceX lunar Starship won't play a role anymore. A 2028 moon landing is just too ridiculously far away for SpaceX. SpaceX will carry out some moon round-trip missions first, the most famous one of course Yuzaku Mitsawa's 2023 moon round-trip with the Dear Moon mission, which maybe could also slip to 2024, depending on how well Starship is advancing. After that, SpaceX will attempt some unmanned Starship landings to bring cargo to the moon, probably in 2024. And if that should be successful, then we might really see the first manned moon landings with astronauts carried out privately by SpaceX, possibly in 2025.
This wouldn't involve NASA or any other government agency. It will be a pure SpaceX mission. SpaceX would then, of course, also start building their own private moon base, possibly in collaboration with other companies, such as Dynetics or Sierra Nevada Corporation. Especially the latter is now really interesting, because they are working on expandable habitat modules. And after the bankruptcy of Bigelow Aerospace, which of course would have been the most logical choice, this leaves Sierra Nevada Corporation as the only ones pursuing this important technology. Quite a few expandable habitat modules could be brought to the moon in one go with Starship, because of its large cargo hold and the very high payload landing capacity on the moon of 100 metric tons. So a moon base could be built extremely fast with Starship. Then we could have a private SpaceX-led moon base by maybe 2026 or 2027, and the government moon bases after 2028. So this could really be a very interesting time on the moon. It will also be very exciting to see what effect the private SpaceX moon base will have on the Russian, Chinese, and American or international moon bases. It will be a fun time on the moon, for sure.
But before we return to the moon, we must unfortunately deal a few more years with boring low Earth orbit, because you know the US decided back in 1972 that low Earth orbit is much cooler than the moon. This is like Columbus sailing to the Americas in 1492 and then afterwards Spain deciding that America is too far, let's just sail around the coast of Spain now for the foreseeable future. So we are stuck in low Earth orbit since 1972, but hey, at least it became a lot cooler now that astronauts are being brought to low Earth orbit by SpaceX's Falcon 9 and Crew Dragon. And yesterday's successful launch of 4 astronauts to the ISS aboard Crew Dragon was another important milestone, because SpaceX is now basically the main launch provider of NASA to get astronauts to the ISS. Not Boeing, not the Russians, but SpaceX. This is really an awesome development and insanely amazing achievement. Also an awesome development is basically everything that is going on at Boca Chica.
So after the last static fire test with Starship SN8, which didn't go so smoothly, in fact almost ended in disaster, now of course the big question arises. What impact will this incident have on the 15-kilometer hop? Well, as it appears, repairs on SN8 are now being carried out. Most notably, one of the Raptor engines, the SN32, has been removed from SN8 and is being replaced with a new Raptor engine. Molten metal apparently leaked out after the shutdown in the last static fire. Maybe other engines will also have to be replaced. But luckily, other than that, SN8 has not been damaged badly. This means that the delay of the 15-kilometer test flight might actually be not as dramatic as we had feared. Of course, the static fire tests will have to be repeated with the new engine or engines, but we estimate that the delay will be only a few weeks. Should, however, the repairs of SN8 take longer than expected, SN9 will promptly take over the testing campaign for the 15-kilometer hop. Either way, we could still see the 15-kilometer test flight this year.
Regarding Super Heavy, not so much has been happening in the last few days because of the SN8 static fire anomaly, but at least more booster sections are waiting now to be stacked, as we can see here. But of course, it will get really interesting once the Super Heavy is fully stacked. That will be a sight to behold. Currently, the Super Heavy is designed, by the way, to have 28 Raptor engines, less than the initially planned 30-something engines, but we'd say this is still impressive enough.
And we are excited to tell you that we will be doing a live stream again this Sunday.
And we might even have one or the other interesting announcement.
So be sure to check out our channel homepage later this week for the exact time.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report as always, and then I would say, on to the future. I would.
This is also good.
Test.
The famous test.
It's recording already, by the way.
Yeah, good.